Tonight on 24 Frames, we hear the story of the Thrift Store Cowboys, one of Lubbock's best and most recognized local bands. We sit down with Lubbock Symphony Orchestra maestro, David Cho. Plus, we'll hear from one of Lubbock's greatest storytellers, Eric Strong, and Brandon Adams in our South Plains sessions. 24 Frames starts right now.
Yeah, I started playing when I was a sophomore in high school. Me and Colt Miller and Jeff Dennis, we started Thrift Store Cowboys. We played in, it's basically the same band, but we had like 25 different names, you know. I had a different name for every show. Just really enjoyed it, and that's kind of, you know, once I graduated from high school, kind of decided that's what I wanted to do, was play music. We started in our first actual show with as Thrift Store Cowboys started in December 19th, 1999. I've known Colt and Jeff since we were little kids and kind of started, I was playing with them throughout high school. And then I guess my second semester at South Plains, this is where I met Amanda. And she basically, I told her we wanted her to play, and she said if I showed up to her Western Swing Ensemble, and she would try it, and she didn't think I would show up, and I sat right in the front row, so made sure she knew I was there. And then she started playing with us, and we've had 13 different drummers, so Tugboat's been our drummer for the longest now. He's been in the band for about 8 years.
They were a band, you know, before I joined, for 4 or 5 years already, you know, and they were super, super solid, and that's what drew me to them. And just for years, I wanted to play in the band because I loved how, you know, like how tight the arrangements were. But it tightened up even up like to another degree, and that's what I loved about it, is that everything was just so polished.
We've done multiple tours out the West Coast and East Coast, and up to Chicago, New York, Seattle, LA, all that stuff. So. Yeah, I mean, it's one of my favorite things to do, is just, you know, getting to go out there and play. And
I love it. It's really difficult, and it's not really for the faint of heart. You know, if people out there, if you've never done it, you know, it seems very glamorous, and it's not.
Everyone's like, man, that must be the most fun. It's like a vacation. It's not really as much, you know, vacation as it is. You're sitting in a van for 6 hours at a time and then doing the same thing over and over and over every single day, you know. But you are getting to play music for people and, you know, get your sound out there. And so that's kind of the main thing that we wanted to do.
I've heard a lot of people say things to us that, you know, that were very positive and very nice, of as far as, like, you know, helping them get involved. And, you know, I will say that I think Daniel was always very supportive and always really, truly wanted the best for other artists, other bands.
Working with, you know, KTXT back in the day and when they were booking shows. And I mean, that was kind of, for me anyways, in my lifetime, that was kind of the pinnacle of Lubbock, the Lubbock music scene anyways. You know, they'd bring in these great bands and, you know, pack out Jake's.
You know, everything is cyclical, and I've seen it go up and down and up and down, and it's, you know, it seems like there's more artists in town now than ever, which is a great thing. That's what you want. You know, you want your scene or whatever, you know, to build and grow, and I feel like it has been. I think it's always gonna change and evolve.
I'm moving to Knoxville, Tennessee, and everybody's getting older, and Clint's, he's married now, he's got a kid, and he's got a pretty much a full-time job. And then Colt's living in Marfa, and he's working, you know, 50 hours a week doing boots, and he's doing great at that. And then, you know, you have Amanda, who's doing fantastic all over the world, you know, playing her music.
I think the one thing that they're gonna lose the most, especially with Daniel and Jess, is that the amount of music that they were bringing to Lubbock, friends and touring artists, you know, needing a place to come through town and trying to share our friends with people here, people that we've met, you know, in our travels. But I think me and Dan will always, I think we'll always play together. Or Dan and I. I don't know what's grammatically correct.
Our music, to a lot of people, they say it sounds kind of what they would picture West Texas sounding like, even though they've never been here before. I'm looking forward to getting to play my music to, you know, a whole different group of people, you know. I've played here for so many years. I've lived here for 13 years and been playing the whole time, you know. So a lot of the people here have heard our songs hundreds of times, you know. So it'll be cool to get to play our music for a new audience. And it'll also be, I'm looking forward, there's lots of great musicians that I already know out there. So I'm really interested to, you know, try and work with some other musicians and try and start something new and everything. And then, like, of course, Amanda lives in Nashville, and so getting to be closer to her and Jason. And, you know, my main goal really is just to play as many shows as I possibly can, opening up for people and just trying to get my name out there and save up enough money where I can just record an album, either do it myself or, you know, we want to do it as a thrift store album. That would work too, but, you know, just trying to get out there and see what happens, you know. I mean, I think it'll just kind of bring a little bit of West Texas to East Tennessee, so.
There's no program like the PBS NewsHour. It's been on the air for more than three decades.
The NewsHour is always going to take you deeper and take you broader. That's even more essential now than I think it ever was.
Now, what we're able to do is to take it to the next step, to coordinate even more closely with what we're doing online.
And we're finally in the position where we can expand our franchise to the weekend as well.
PBS NewsHour Weekend is kind of a natural evolution for the Monday to Friday program.
The world is more complicated than it's ever been. People have more access to sources of news than they've ever had.
And what the NewsHour does is it tells you not only what happened that day, but digs a little deeper.
Night after night, 7 days a week, we're consistently different than what the audiences get on broadcast television.
There has to be a destination where you can get the information, and it's still going to take you someplace you didn't even know you wanted to go.
That's the NewsHour.
Eric Strong is one of Lubbock's greatest storytellers and artists.
What I wanted to share with you is a story about a little boy who's about your age.
In fact, everywhere he goes, he brings his art with him.
He was in his backyard. The Dunbar Band would march around the community, and they'd be playing their drums. And this young man could get tree limbs or whatever, beat on an oil drum, and he could keep up with the band.
He never misses an opportunity to share some of his greatest tales.
Mr. Roberts, I can keep up with your band. Listen to this. And he played the drums for him. And Mr. Roberts said, we had a practice room at Dunbar. This is before Dunbar was at this school. He says, we got a practice room. You can use that practice room. And he every day he would practice. He got some real drumsticks. He had a set of drums. He would practice and practice and practice. And he got really good. One day he goes home. There's two cars parked at his house. And one of these cars is Mr. Roberts' car, the band director. He said, oh my goodness, somebody did something in the band room. I'm in trouble. He goes into the house. He takes a deep breath, goes inside, and Mr. Roberts said, this is James Otis Price. He said, he's the young man I've been telling you about. He's one of the best drummers that we have in Lubbock. And the man stood up. He said, so you're James Otis Price. He said, you know, our drummer got sick. We have a concert tomorrow night, and we really would like for you to play your drums. Mr. Roberts says you're one of the best drummers in this town. And he said, by the way, I'm B.B. King. And B.B. King stood up and he shook James Otis Price's hands. And James Otis Price performed with B.B. King. How I started telling stories was I like history. And I used to lecture about history. And I had to lecture to a group of kids in St. Louis. And I talked about some of the history of this, the Buffalo Soldiers, Black Mountain Men, explorers, and things like that, African-American things. An article came out in the St. Louis Post-Dispatch. And I think this was in 1987, this article came out. And it says, Texas Storyteller. And it talked about what I was doing with the kids, how much the kids liked it. And I was like, a storyteller? I didn't even know that's what it was called. I had never seen in my life another African-American storyteller. I never had. And then, eventually I met a couple of people, but I found out about this guy who was my hero. And this guy's name was Brother Blue. And you can get pictures of Brother Blue to show it this. But Brother Blue had blue butterflies painted in his palms of his hands. And he was a street storyteller. And he had gotten a degree from Harvard, a PhD from Yale or wherever. And he was a storyteller. Louise Underwood made the opportunity available for me to meet Brother Blue. So that's kind of how I started telling stories. And I went to the National Association of Black Storytellers, and I got to see a lot of storytellers. And it was so, I feel like I'd come somewhere and discovered a lot of cousins that I never knew. So it's a neat process. Some of the stories that I like to tell, 7,000-8,000 years old, but the stories still work kind of the same way. I like African folk tales, one of my favorite kinds of stories. In Zimbabwe, there is a river. And this river is called the Zambezi River. Stories are so basic. Now, something inside of our brains, stories activate that. And it's a way, to, especially life lessons. If you can put life lessons in the form of a story, in the form of people will internalize those lessons for a greater length of time. A lot of the people would go to see Kole, the blind basket maker, for Kole was completely blind, and he was selling the most beautiful baskets, and his sister was there alongside of him. And Kole would say, baskets, baskets. Kole's got baskets, baskets. Brown ones, green ones, yellow ones too. Ah, here's a blue one just for you. Stories were a way that people communicated, and we still have a big storytelling culture. Stories are a way to reach people. They say he sees with his ears, but he hears with his ears. He sees with his heart. And that is the story of Kole, the blind basket maker.
My name is David Cho, and I'm currently the music director of the Lubbock Symphony Orchestra. And I was born in South Korea back in 1974. My whole family immigrated to the States in 1985. My parents are musically inclined, so my brother and I have one younger brother. We were encouraged strongly to pick up an instrument. We both played the piano. I would listen to Johann Strauss Sr.'s Radetzky March, and I would start conducting. I was an infant. Apparently I was on my mother's back, and I would start conducting, you know, tapping to the beat of the music. And she told me the story that, oh, but even back then I knew that you would be some sort of a musician.
Yeah, well, I hear a lot of Zach, but not enough of Kimberly when you had the tune. Am I contradicting what you're already working on?
Well, it's the age old.
Okay. And there's a section where you do all Mark and Richard do the bass line, bop, bop, mm-hmm. bop. Is that all pits or there's some arcos?
First part is pits and then arcos.
Okay.
One of the interesting things about being a conductor is, like anything else, I guess, it's a lifelong pursuit, and it takes a lot of practice and study time, and I think it takes love for music to keep going, because there's a lot of hurdles to go through.
Sure, a lot of people who aren't musically inclined or aren't technically really into music that much but might come to the symphony, they see someone kind of waving their arms around. They might not know exactly what your job is as the maestro. Could you kind of explain that, exactly what you're looking for and what goes into your job?
I'm sure a much more seasoned conductor would tell you something more deeper and philosophical, but I'm still a young conductor. I define a orchestral conductor or opera conductor as somebody, you know, much older, with much more experience, not only with music, but with life. And I'm just under 40, so I'm still learning my craft. So I guess my answer to your question would be very basic. My job is to prepare the music and have the great masterworks, whether it's by Mozart, Beethoven, or Mahler, and help the orchestra to realize how the music should go. It could be tempo, or it could be how speed of music, the nuance of music, style, and helping this 80 to 100 musicians to play together and in a more unified way, because we have many personalities in the orchestra, and one of my jobs is to coax them to play in unison, play with the same idea. And most of the time, if you come to the concert, you'll probably see this, because my face is facing the orchestra and my back is to the audience. So I guess in a way I'm sort of an ambassador, like a connecting tissue from the symphony orchestra to the audience.
That was good, yeah.
Call the Midwife returns to PBS this spring.
It's not just a myth.
TV Guide says it is one of the top 10 shows of the year.
How perfectly marvelous.
As touching, funny, and life-affirming as ever.
Well, that's exceptionally generous.
It's charming.
Bravo.
With great storytelling.
It sounds terribly dramatic.
It's one of TV's treasures.
I suppose I shall have to take that as a compliment.
In the blink of an eye, the world has changed. 30 years have come and gone. There have been wars and peace. Justice has been served and denied. fortunes, won and lost. And we watched it all, on big screens and small. On big screens and small. In the blink of an eye, it will be 2043. In the next 30 years, wars will be fought. Economies will crash. People will rise up. Nations will fall. And technology will evolve. Each new generation makes its own history. And a new generation of Frontline will be here to tell it. Frontline. Thought-provoking journalism, wherever and whenever you find us.
My name is Brandon Adams. I have a band called Brandon Adams and the Sad Bastards from here in Lubbock, Texas. And I moved here back in the mid-90s. I thought rock and roll was the coolest thing to see live, and Lubbock's a cool town for it. Everybody here is pretty badass. Great musicians, cool bands. And all the clubs are pretty cool. They take good care of us. It's such a long drive to everywhere else in the world. So we have to entertain ourselves and play rock and roll here. You know, when you start a band, you're taking on more than just the music. You're taking on, you're hiring people, you know, you're paying them, you're taking care of them, it's their livelihood as well. And then you think about all your road stuff, traveling, everything, and just, it's just more. And it's a lot to think about, a lot to take in. It's something I think maybe a lot of the young guys, you know, starting out, I was the same way, you know, like you didn't really think about this stuff when you said, I want to start a band. And when you do, you're taking on a lot. You're taking on a ton of responsibility. But it's the best job in the world. It's great. I've done a whole bunch of projects with people here in Lubbock. You know, a lot of co-writes. I've been on some albums. And that, to me, is just as fulfilling as writing my own records. It's just, it's, you know, it's part of the job. It's really fun. I don't really write songs for other people. I write them for me. So I hope that affects them, and I hope that they have a great time at our shows, and I hope that they jam our CD and relate to it in any way, like if it makes them sad, you know, makes them think about somebody they loved or any of that stuff. I'm going to be on the road soon with Red Shahan and Charlie Shafter. We're going to be up the Blue Light on Wednesday, March 12th. It's just going to be an acoustic tour, which is pretty rad with those fellas, because they're pretty fun guys. Great songwriters and excellent performers, so I think it's gonna rock. We're pretty much doing all of West Texas. We're gonna go out to Dallas Fort Worth area for a while, and it's gonna be 2 weeks. So I don't know. I hope everybody can come out. It should be a good time. We're all Blue Light guys, so we've been playing together for like, I don't know, 6 or 7 years now, and that's where we all met. And I'm glad that we get to come back and do it here at the Blue Light again. Rock and roll.
Why you gotta treat me so bad? no good. What is a boy do? So soft and tender, like the bruises I remember as a baby bird on the ground after the fall. Broken arms and broken wings, I still try to fly away. I never knew how to fly. I got no.